a very early age, 13, involved in nothing but arts. Much to dismay of my father, who sent me there because he'd sent his other boy. My father was a school janitor, by the way, who had pretensions. I mean, being the son of a school janitor in town head is a bit like being the son of the local Nazi party official. You're not trusted. Anyway, the point is, he sent me there because he didn't want me to turn out to my elder brother, who he called a dreamy boy. My father thought a dreamy boy was somebody that couldn't make a table from start to finish in 3 minutes. So, I found myself displaced, culturally displaced. I went to London and then eventually I got a job as an art teacher. Utterly, totally unqualified in Hamilton, St. John's Grammar, and it was wonderful, it was great. And then I decided at age 26 to make myself legitimate. But it was decided for me because they were sacking everybody because they qualified. And quite right too. And we were WTs as they called them. And I went to Edinburgh College of Art and it was there that I discovered writing. Quite simply because I was working for the Nigel students as a one of the officials. Not working for them, I was elected. I was one of the two vice presidents myself from Cape Town. The president at the time was Jack Straw, who was an absolute idiot then and he's remained so. But anyway, I remember when Tony Blair formed his first cabinet. I knew virtually everybody in the cabinet, apart from Tony Blair, because all of them had made their career out of the National Union students. They were absolute careerists. But then after that, I went into teaching. But by that time, I was also working as a journalist. I started in 1970, actually, I suppose I started originally, 1972, working for the Guardian and the Times, doing articles about young people. Actually, it was helped to the fact that I would be 27, 28, and a spokesperson for people who were 17 and 18 and thus idiots. So I was able to make this sound of even more sensible than 17 and 18 olds can be. Then I went to the Scotsman after an article I wrote for them in 76. And from then until 2008, I produced a column every week for 32 years without a break. Now, I'm quite proud of that in a way, but the other thing that makes me really proud of that in a way is quite simple. People boast that they've worked for this and that. I did it every week because it was easy. And when people ask you that question, they constantly do. How do you get your ideas? How can you not get them? You get them 18 times a day. If you use taxis, you get in pubs, and you find yourself out in the street, talking to folk as you've been doing your messages. There's an idea every 10 minutes. As for newspapers, think of the plethora of rubbish that comes up in newspapers. It's quite easy to pick up an idea for a column. The other day I was in the hospital getting this heart monitor. It's a big poster and they've got two boxes, and one box says boys, and another box says girls, a poster. And it says, this is not big, not gender. Well, sadly it bloody is. Actually, in a way, if you look in the dictionary, you will discover that what they really mean is sex. Gender belongs to, it means kind, and it belongs to plants. And more than anything else, but then so many of these words have changed, and this is one of the things that I'm not going to take up too much of your time, but I notice that a lot of words change. Listen, for instance, nowadays nobody says proved, they say proven. There are only two reasons why you should use the word proven. One, if it applies to metal alloys, as in proven steel, or as in not proven in the courts, in the Scottish courts. The other one is proved, but fashion decrees otherwise. Or how about systemic, rather than systematic. Well, systematic means about the systems. Systemic just means of a system, and it's entirely medical. And the one that gets me, that I can't believe, is apparently metaphorical means the same as literally. God also means gets me. Well, I literally don't believe that's true. But the point I'm making with is that these are words, they're the parole of every writer. If you don't start off with words, and I'm afraid a lot of people who want to become writers, and there may be one or two in here, in the same way that I can remember in the art show, young people who wanted more to be an artist than a creator. Alexander Pope talked about that in the Dunciad. People who fill their minds with the lumber of books. And that can be a danger. But at the same time, they're not talking here about words, and fancies about grammar and syntax, the importance of it in my life. I see a level of beauty in grammar and syntax that I understand mathematicians mad as they are finding maths. But there's no question that the words have become important, and the expression, and the way you put them together in order to organise something we mean people think in the same way you do, or get the same expression, the same impression. Sometimes something even weirder. If I get a circumstance which I don't suffer from, a delight in, called synesthesia. It means it's a scientific term as well, and medically it can be very useful if it's discovered a while back in the heart attack. I was asked, could I describe the pain, which is very difficult. And I said, describe it in colour. And the consultant, who's a young woman, said, synesthesia. It's not uncommon, it's really quite rare. Tell me the colour of the pain. And I told her, this is pink. She said, right. In relation to what? This is brown's the slightest. But I see words in colour as well. Names. Days of the week. That ability to shift that about is always a kind of, dare I say, a metaphor for a talent that a proper writer has, or an artist. I've worked with so many artists who are better than me. You know, painters, draftsmen, illustrators. I'm a good and very capable illustrator. I mean that, and I've earned a bit of money out of it, but I know that I'm not as good as other people. Because that's one thing you learn when you go to university and art college. There's always someone better than you. And what I did discover is that there's a certain thing about just wanting to write is not the same thing. Find yourself compelled to do it, and I don't know how to explain it other than making it sound pretentious, but there is a compulsion to do it. That's the synesthesia, that's the exercise for some reason that you have to. Why? It's like you try and don't be egotistical about it. And I do in my columns, there was a certain didactic that I didn't want to make people think exactly what I thought or feel what I felt. Actually, when I think of it right and the craft of it, there's still a function there that has got to underlie a writer. And I don't think it's been somewhat better than the John Reith when he said that the BBC was there to inform, educate and entertain. Well, I think that's absolutely right. The information is the means by which you educate. The entertainment is the means to make the information palatable. But I still think the function of a writer is really, at the end of the day, to educate. Now that's a kind of puritanical thing, possibly Northern European, but it goes right across in American literature. When Arnold Kent, who was my editor, asked me, when I asked him to write the introduction of the collection, first collection of columns. And that was, as I say, from early days, back in the 70s. He wrote a thing about, he said, a prose with dreadlock of the street, but also with a curious need it more than no to tell. And that was true. And the reason for that is how much I read and where the reading came from. From my grandmother, from reading Scott and Dickens, and from my old teacher, Pammy Engels, from Hazlitt, Addison, and Steele. And then people like, these are people that some of you are too young to know or remember, know of at all. People like, for instance, Sir H.H. Munro, or who remembers Arnold Bennett now? He's not known at all. H.G. Wells is only known, for instance, he's a massive figure. He's only known for sort of War of the Worlds. Damon Runyon, James Thurber. I deplore the fact that there's no longer much there. Because it not only was an impetus to me and made sure that I created a kind of style for myself, but it was understood. I know that quite a lot of my readers, even back in the 70s, were a bit, found me a bit obscure sometimes. But most of them didn't. Unfortunately, there is less reading and there's less of that material coming across. If it weren't for Jane Austen and Mrs. Gaskell, I doubt very much if many people would know Victorian novel. Dickens as well, of course. Much, I think, transfigured nowadays in various television programmes. But the point I'm making is that the reading that I did, is and it was massive amount of reading, fueled me into doing what I do as a writer, as a journalist. And I really don't see any difference between good writing for newspapers. I never thought of myself as a journalist, although I've done a lot of stuff. I mean, I've worked in sport, art, and any plenty of things, in politics, anything you can think of. I've worked in broadcasting, I've worked in advertising, and all these things. But the point I'm making is that it all started off with writing, and this is where any of you here are aspiring writers, and some of you are, I know, fully accomplished writers, and earn your living out of it. We don't really know why we do it. It really pays that well. And for those who often are paid very well, they're either not very good or they don't care anyway. What I want to say at the end of the day is that any of you here who wants to aspire to be a writer, the last point I can think of is whatever I say to young people, it's only advice I've given young people is worth a damn. And that is never stay in a job if you hate it, and never leave it.